Mohsin Hamid is one of the authors that really doesn't need an introduction at this very animate Karachi Literary Festival. I could tell you about his fabulous first novel, Mot Smoke, about its critical acclaim. I could tell you how his second novel, The Reluctant Fundamentalist, was a bestseller, sold several hundred thousand, perhaps a million copies, how it was shortlisted or longlisted for the Booker. But I'm more interested in talking about his latest work, because I have been unemployed since 2003, and I want to know, how does one get filthy rich in rising Asia?
Thank you, first of all, to everyone here and to H.M.Naqvi, who's kindly agreed to do this today. You know, if you want to know how to get filthy rich in rising Asia, unfortunately, you may not necessarily find the secret in this book. But with that disclaimer aside, I think that H.M. and I can now reveal that if you become a literary novelist, you know, that's probably the easiest way. As we know, everybody who writes books is fabulously wealthy. So I would suggest that we all, you know, become poets and fiction writers. But basically, the novel, it pretends to be a self-help book about how to get filthy rich in rising Asia. But it's maybe something slightly different.
So, you know, there's something that I've noticed about your work is the sort of what I would characterize as the architecture of your narrative. And if I remember correctly, Mot Smoke was informed by this historical paradigm. There was the architecture was informed by Mughlai history. Your second novel is in many ways a sort of dialogue. And this third novel also has a very novel premise and a novel architecture. Do you conceptualize the genesis of your novels? Do you conceptualize how you're going to go about doing something like this?
You know, there was an earlier event today where I quoted a great writer, and I'm going to quote him again. So those of you who heard this, I excuse me for the repetition, but it's the best way to explain. Is that better? Okay. The best way to explain what I do. So Douglas Adams, author of The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, writes that the secret to flying is throwing yourself at the ground and missing. And I think that's sort of, in a nutshell, my approach to novel writing. So when I start writing a novel, I have an idea that I'm going to write about this, and I'm going to do it this way. And then I fail, and I write another draft, and I fail again. And over the course of the drafts, eventually a kind of architecture starts to come. And it's not until I get the architecture that the novel eventually unlocks itself. So in the case of Mot Smoke, the first drafts weren't written as a trial. It was a straight story of this guy. Reluctant Fundamentalist initially was not written as a Pakistani man speaking to a stranger that we don't hear from. It was written as a straight narrative, and it didn't work. And this time, I tried to write hello? Please. Thank you. And so, you know, this time I didn't set out to write a self-help book type novel. I was originally writing it as like a collage of very short fictions, which failed horribly. And then it became this. And I think, you know, every writer has different ways of unlocking their writing. And for me, I think stumbling around and figuring out the architecture of my books is sort of how I figure out how to write them.
That's very interesting, because I work very differently. I find that if I have not been able to create a three-dimensional character, I can't put him in the next scene. So we work differently. I'm curious, we work differently in that way. For the last 9 years, I have had a peculiar schedule. So I work till 6 in the morning. I wake in the 2 in the afternoon. I have breakfast at 3. I work from about 4 to 6. I take a break. I work, my second session is from about 8 to 11. And then I have lunch, 11 p.m. And so on. Do you have a very regimented writing schedule?
I do. It's interesting what you said just before I answered that, what you said earlier about, you know, that you have to create the three-dimensional character before you can imagine the next thing. You know, for me, in a way, the way I try to create a character, or the way I try to create a space where I can feel comfortable writing the next thing, is figuring out the voice of the book. And I find that, you know, particularly if it's like this novel is not so much told in the narrator's voice, obviously, but my previous two novels were in a narrator's voice, and I figured when I can understand how this person talks, I get the character, and then I feel comfortable going forward. This one is a bit different because it's not told in the voice of the character. In terms of how I work, each book has been different. The first book I wrote at night, actually, most of the time from sort of midnight to dawn. I didn't work during the day on it, so you're a better man than me, but I used to do the night shift. And then my second novel, I had a job much of the time, so I wrote it on weekends and days off. I worked part-time. And this book, I wrote largely after becoming a father, so we'd be up at 6 in the morning with a crying baby, my wife and I. Well, she would be up and I would also get up. And so I began writing this one by taking a walk first thing in the morning. So at about 6 or 7, I go for a 1 hour walk. And at the end of an hour long walk, I'm so full of stuff I want to write because I've been texting myself and I've been thinking about stuff. When you're working on a book, as H.M. knows, these, you know, ideas keep coming to you. And if you're not at your computer, it's this crazy thing of, you know, what do I do with it?
You text ideas to yourself.
Yes. So basically, you know, sometimes I can't help it. I try to not write anything, but I'm just walking around. And at some point I say, I have to write this paragraph down. So then I compose it and I email it to myself or text it to myself. And when I get to my computer, it's there. And then I write really in the mornings now, 7, 8 a.m. till 1, 2, 3. And if I can get 5 or 6 good hours in, I've had a good day.
5, 6 hours?
Yeah, five, 6 writing hours, yeah. Oh, so one other thing I should say about the writing process is probably most of the time I spent writing, I'm actually reading. Not other people's work, what I'm working on. So if, let's say, I'm writing for 7 hours, you know, a lot of that time, or 5 hours, will be spent printing out manuscript pages or looking at my computer and reading the thing over and over, you know, trying to figure out why it doesn't work or, you know, does it or not. I think a lot of my writing is done by ear, so I have to hear it over and over again to be able to process the writing.
You know, I have a daily quota of words, and it's sort of a very discrete quota. It's 300 words a day, and that's 2 paragraphs. It's not a hell of a lot, and so there was a time when I would think about how many hours I devote to my manuscript, and now, sort of 9 years into it, I have reassessed the benchmark, the daily benchmark, and that's the way I do it. But you know, this texting yourself is something that I had not thought of before, and perhaps I, this will inform my next project. Mohsin, I was also curious. I was also curious about where you locate yourself in the tradition of literature. So, you know, the tradition of literature in the subcontinent goes back perhaps 200 years. There was a personality, there was a writer by the name of Deen Muhammad who hailed from Bihar, and he's said to be the first South Asian writing in English. And then we have Malkaraj Anand and Ahmad Ali and Atiya Hussain. So there's that sort of tradition. I was weaned on the works of R.K. Narayan and sort of and other novelists. But as far as this region is concerned, do you find that you summon this particular tradition, or do you think of yourself as informed by other traditions?
You know, I've been thinking about this question. I was trying to think, you know, what have I read? Because there's a way to answer the question where you actually link the dots intellectually or post facto. But you can also just say, what have you read? And I think if I look at what I read, I was weaned, you know, on the works of you know, Tolkien and Frank Herbert and the epic guides of Gary Gygax and the rest of the Dungeons and Dragons TSR kingdom. I mean, basically, I read fantasy and science fiction and you know, those kinds of books as a kid, and I didn't really turn to literature. Except for children's literature like Charlotte's Web and Wind in the Willows, and I mean that was hugely informative to me as a writer, I think, as a reader, and you know, Asterix and Obelix and Tintin. I didn't really get into literature until my late teens, and then I did go into a lot of the Western canon, I guess you would say.
The Russians?
Yeah, I mean, I think the Russians, yes. But I guess there were some writers that I read and admired. You know, there's some people that you meet and admire. And other writers that I read and, you know, wanted to be like. And and so I admired Tolstoy, but I didn't want to be like Tolstoy as a writer. I think, you know, it was much more, you know, Nabokov, I liked Calvino and Camus, and I liked you know, some of the rhythms in African American writing, James Baldwin and Toni Morrison and
Ellison, Invisible Man.
You know, I still haven't read Invisible Man. It's like a huge gap in my reading. There are many such gaps, but it's one of the huge gaps.
It's a small gap. He only wrote one book.
Yeah, but a big book.
Very big book.
So you know, I think, and even now when I look at writers around the world that I'm excited by new work of, actually I would say now I probably read much more Desi stuff than I did before, because there's a lot more stuff that excites me coming out of Pakistan and this area than there was before. But with the exception of, you know, probably Manto, there wasn't anybody that I kept on my bookshelf to look at from time to time. You know, I would read things. And so I guess if I had to say, you know, what is it? You know, I've been attracted to an aesthetic of leanness in prose. You know, and Manto is an exemplar of that. But, you know, I mean, if Manto was a boxer, you know, he'd be a sort of flyweight that boxes with, you know, super heavyweights, because in a very, very short story, you pack more punch than, you know, Borges. Some of these writers would do that. They would write little and achieve a huge amount. And the other thing which I always found very exciting was, you know, was architecture. How does a novel get built? How does it work? What's it up to? And particularly modernist architecture. You know, like, so all of them mid 20th century plays with how a book can work. And I think you know, I think that people are changing, society is changing, the way you read is changing, culture is changing. And because those things are changing, stories sort of stay the same, but the container that you put the story into has to change as well. And so I'm always interested in seeing how you can build a novel and build stories that do things differently. And also, I think it's what inspires you as a writer. So a lot of rhyming poetry, sort of, you know, not free verse, but poetry with rules, you know, meter.
Romantics.
Well, not, I'm not a big reader of it. Hip-hop. But the way it works, and you're a poet, so you'll know much more about this than me, but I think partly it's the rhythm of the form inspires you. You know, you have to make the beats work. You have to make the meter work. And in a strange way, that's not a restriction. It's a catalyst. And for me, I think formal games work like that. Once I figured out that this book will be in the structure of a self-help book, told in the second person to you, you are the character of this book. It was actually pretty easy after that. It just took 5 years to figure that out. But once I had figured that out, it came easily. So I think structure helps me. And I look to writers who do things like that.
Perhaps the more interesting question is, which writer did you want to be like? You wanted to be like Hemingway, who drank martinis after midday and wrestled alligators and shot game in Kenya? Or do you want to be like Manto?
You know, well, as the problem with
wanting persona. Yes. The persona.
Well, you know, the thing about the persona side of it is, it's very funny, but the more I write, the more I think it's important to stay away from public reflections of yourself. Because, and I try to now almost never do, you know, TV interviews or whatever, only because I feel like I get confused. I think when I start making public appearances and giving interviews and spouting nonsense, I start believing my nonsense. And then, and as a writer, that's sort of deadly, because you start saying things about yourself and you say it 20 times, actually you convince yourself. You know, two things have happened to me since I became a published writer. You know, one is I've realized that talking about yourself can really confuse you, because you say things, you believe them, and then later you reflect and you realize, you know, that wasn't true. Why am I convincing myself of this idiocy? And the other thing is I've lost my signature. I can't sign a check anymore. I've signed books and my signature has become this sort of blob. And whenever I try to concentrate and sign properly, I fail. So I have to have this thing with my bank where, you know, I call them, no, it's really me, come in, show your ID card, you know, no, you need your new NIC and this is a NICOP or whatever. And, you know, so for me, the loss of my signature is a bit symbolic, that I can't sign like myself anymore. So as far as the persona thing is concerned, I increasingly try to keep to myself.
That makes two of us. Also, we are sort of hum umar hain. We're roughly the same age. I was curious. We probably have another good 20, 25 years left as far as this stamina that is required to write novels. There are novelists like Jose Saramago, who started at 60, and Philip Roth in his 80s is still at it. How many more books do you have in you?
I don't know. You know, I don't know. It's a good question. I mean, my first two books took 7 years each, and my second one took six. So I've been writing novels for 20 years.
So let's do the math there. That's 25 divided by 6.
20 by 3. So it's like 7-ish. Oh. Just under 7. Oh. So I'm a 7-year novelist. And hopefully I'll speed up and get to 5 or something. But I don't know how many books I have in me. And, you know, I think it's something slightly different, which is, how long will I have this compulsion of sitting in front of a computer by myself? That's really what it comes down to. Because, you know, you publish books which come out of sitting in front of the computer by yourself. But basically, you know, what we do for a living is not this, you know, or even really this. You know, what we do is just stare at words for years, which is, you know, quite insane if you think about it as an activity. And so if the insanity goes, then maybe the books go.
Are you insane?
You know, I think my wife would say yes. No, I would say very honestly that I'm unstable. You know, that if I don't write books, I start to get unhappy. And I start to get edgy. I start to get depressed. I start to get unpleasant. And so because I'm out of whack, spending, you know, years making stuff up, playing make-believe like a child, basically, is how I exist. And when I'm writing, I ground myself. I'm solid. You know, I can be.
Sin.
Yeah. I mean, well, not even sane, but I mean, who knows what sanity is, and I'm not sure I'm a big fan of it, even if I, you know, did know what it was. But it, for me, the main thing is that, you know, you've got a certain number of years on this planet, and do you really want to spend a bunch of them staring at a computer screen working with words? I often ask myself this, why are you doing this? There's sun out there, people are hanging out. You know, somewhere Hemingway's ghost is getting wasted on martinis. You know, why not do that? And I think, you know, you have to have a very good reason not to, because all jokes aside, our job is, you know, very lonely and doesn't pay very well. So for me, I think that, you know, I was a child who liked to play make-believe, like all children do. You know, that instead of H.M. and I here talking to you, we're actually sitting on the deck of a ship. He's got a fishing rod in his hand. I'm scanning the horizon for sharks, and there we are. That was
nice.
Being a child. But I think, unlike many people, I've never stopped doing that. And I do it professionally now. And I think for some people, making stuff up is what they need to do, and I've tried to ask myself why that's the case, and maybe it's the case partly because I don't know the answer. This is one of those dangerous things to say, because if I say something wrong, I might start believing it and fool myself. But I think part of the answer is that as you're growing up, you sometimes look at the world and think, I don't want it to be this way. You know, I want it to be different. I want to be an adult. I want to be on a boat. I want there to be a shark. I want to catch it. And for me now, I mean, although it's difficult to imagine, I look at Pakistan and I think, I don't want it to be, you know, this way. You know, because we know how lovely and perfect Pakistan is, but somehow for me, it's slightly off. And so I, you know, And partly it's the world rubs you slightly the wrong way. So I think that comes back to the basic of it. And in fact, this book, the reason in a way that I thought writing it as a self-help book was worth pursuing is because I've come to realize that for me, my novels are self-help books. You know, I write books to help myself. But also, I read books to help myself. You know, not to learn how to get filthy rich, although I, you know, wish I could read a book that would tell me that. But because when I read a novel, you know, I am transported beyond myself. I connect with something else. I'm moved. I'm shifted. And I think there's something about self-help in the act of reading also. So it's partly a joke, the idea the book is a self-help book, but it's also deadly serious at the same time.
You know, I find your take on it incisive, and but I also find it somewhat whimsical. In that, do you feel, and I think, do you feel as a Pakistani novelist, do you have a certain responsibility? You know, I had said in a session 20 minutes ago that, you know, Nabokov, who escaped Tsarist Russia, a communist Russia, his family was white Russian, never wrote about politics. He wrote about an old man's affections for a prepubescent girl. Whereas Naipaul is configured to think of his post-colonial predicament and these anxieties pervade his oeuvre. Do you feel that you have a responsibility like Naipaul does, or are you do you think of yourselves differently?
I don't know about responsibility. I think responsibility is too strong a word for me. Partly it's because I've never liked to be told what to do. It's very strong in my nature that I just really, really don't like, you know, to be told anything, which is why I don't work for anyone and I make up the world in my books.
I'm a, you know. Shadi qaim, eh?
Yeah, shadi, well. Only one person can tell me what to do. She's married to me, so I'm, but one boss is enough. And actually my daughter also can do that. A few bosses maximum in life. And the thing about it is that, so I don't think writers should do anything. I think writers write enough. And in our country, everybody's telling us what we should do and shouldn't do. You know, you shouldn't drink, you shouldn't do this, you shouldn't do that, you should believe this way, look that way, treat this person that way, etc. I hate it. So no should. But personally, I feel compelled to engage politically. Not that it's my responsibility necessarily, but it's my nature. And so I do want to do that. For me, it's important to do that. But if at some point, you know, it ceases to be my nature and I want to write about hobbits, you know, in Middle Earth, you know, without any kind of metaphorical comparison to Pakistan or, you know, I think that's fine. And I would be happy to do it. But, you know, if I had to think of any response, no, I can't put the word on it.
Pakistan sometimes does feel like Middle Earth, huh?
Yes, well, you know, Pakistan is a lot so like wrong. Middle Earth. Yeah, and I feel, you know, I feel quite hobbit-like. I don't feel like a very powerful actor. I mean, there's big monsters out there, ring wraiths and things. And it's scary, you know. It is scary to look out at this country and society, and not just our country and society, but this planet. But you know, one of the things that art does, that writing does, is it connects. So when I read a writer that I like, I feel I'm accompanied, you know, by someone I'm interested in being accompanied by. And since so much of our existing political system and religious discourse and governance model, economy, is based on isolating each and every one of us, making each of us feel that, no, you are a Punjabi, Sunni, Lahori man, blah, 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 and therefore you are an isolated little unit. You're all by yourself, and on top of that, you're under suspicion of being not Muslim enough, not this enough, not that enough. You start feeling that you're alone. and you're scared, and because you're alone and scared, it's easy to be manipulated, and you can be manipulated into hating whoever people want you to hate. So in that sense, I think connecting, you know, is an important function, even separate from the politics of what you say, but just having, establishing connections with human beings is a meaningful act politically.
So why don't you connect with this audience and read a few pages of your self-help manual?
Okay.
Well, 3-4 minutes?
Sure. Here we go. I'll start at the beginning. The book will be out in a couple of weeks. I'm sorry, I tried to get my publishers to rush it and have it in time for the festival. It's not here. There's the first chapter is being given out free as a pamphlet, and hopefully some of you will be able to get that. Look, unless you're writing one, a self-help book is an oxymoron. You read a self-help book so someone who isn't yourself can help you. That's someone being the author. This is true of the whole self-help genre. It's true of how-to books, for example. And it's true of personal improvement books, too. Some might even say it's true of religion books. But some others might say that those who say that should be pinned to the ground and bled dry with a slow slice of a blade across their throats. So it's wisest simply to note a divergence of views on that subcategory and move swiftly on. None of the foregoing means self-help books are useless. On the contrary, they can be useful indeed. But it does mean that the idea of self in the land of self-help is a slippery one. And slippery can be good. Slippery can be pleasurable. Slippery can provide access to what would chafe if entered dry. This book is a self-help book. Its objective, as it says on the cover, is to show you how to get filthy rich in rising Asia. And to do that, it has to find you, huddled, shivering, on the packed earth under your mother's cot one cold, dewy morning. Your anguish is the anguish of a boy whose chocolate has been thrown away, whose remote controls are out of batteries, whose scooter is busted, whose new sneakers have been stolen. This is all the more remarkable since you've never in your life seen any of these things. The whites of your eyes are yellow, a consequence of spiking bilirubin levels in your blood. The virus afflicting you is called hepatitis E. Its typical mode of transmission is fecal oral. Yum. It kills only about 1 in 50, so you're likely to recover. But right now, you feel like you're going to die. Your mother has encountered this condition many times, or conditions like it anyway. So maybe she doesn't think you're going to die. Then again, maybe she does. Maybe she fears it. Everyone is going to die. And when a mother like yours sees in a third-born child like you the pain that makes you whimper under her cot the way you do, maybe she feels your death push forward a few decades, take off its dark, dusty headscarf, and settle with open-haired familiarity and a lascivious smile into this, the single mud-walled room she shares with all of her surviving offspring. What she says is, don't leave us here. Your father has heard this request of hers before. This does not make him completely unsusceptible to it, however. He is a man of voracious sexual appetite, and he often thinks while he is away of your mother's heavy breasts and solid, ample thighs, and he still longs to thrust himself inside her nightly, rather than just 3 or 4 visits per year. He also enjoys her unusually rude sense of humor and sometimes her companionship as well. And although he is not given to displays of affection towards their young, he would like to watch you and your siblings grow. His own father derived considerable pleasure from the daily progress of crops in the fields. And in this, at least insofar as it is analogous to the development of children, the two men are similar. Thank you.
Fantastic. That is something one should think about when aspiring to this ideal of becoming rich. It's how you start off. I think we can take a couple of questions. Do you have questions for Mohsin Hamid? Not a single person has a question.
There's somebody
for
back there.
We've got one and we need a mic.
Gentleman, black on the... Oh. No, no?
No.
Back there.
The second pillar.
Yeah.
Sir, in Pakistan context, how do we distinguish between remarkable literature and shoddy literature? If I would say literature, how do we distinguish between an obscure and random opus in Pakistan context? What I mean to say, that whenever we write ugly things about Pakistan, it is a claim that is good writing. And whenever we write some good things, beautiful things,
I don't know. I mean, I'm not sure that that's true, that only ugly things about Pakistan are considered to be good writing. But partly my response to what you've just asked is, this book doesn't use the word Pakistan once. The word Pakistan doesn't exist. There's no Islam, no Christianity, no mosque, no Lahore, no Karachi, no Mohsin, no H.M.Naqvi. There's no names. It's just a place, and just people. And I made that decision very consciously because I was sort of, you know, there were a couple of reasons, but two important reasons were, one, there's this burden of Pakistan. Who can explain Pakistan? What is Pakistan? Etc., etc. And I thought, you know, so much is said about Pakistan. How do I know that what I think about this place is really what I think and not what I've read H.M. Naqvi write or Muhammad Hanif write or the newspapers write or whatever? I've read so much about this country that I feel, in a way, the brand of Pakistan and Lahore and Islam and all of these things have been given to me by others. And so I thought, if I want to see things for myself, I have to take away the brands. So there's no names in this book. That's the first thing. But the other part of it is this idea that, you know, you are representing Pakistan. It's a different way of thinking about, probably, literature than the way I think about it. There are many different Pakistani writers, some of them writing about Pakistan, most of them probably, and each having different things to say. I want to say what I want to say. And that's my project. And I thought I would be more free to say what I want to say if I don't write about Pakistan. I've written about some place. It may be entirely similar to Lahore, but it doesn't say it's Lahore. So I think that's a personal choice. But to your question about great literature and not great literature, nobody decides what great literature is. Great literature is a marketing term used by many people to apply to certain kinds of books. Now, I have very strong views about what I think great literature is, and I'm happy to debate that with anybody who thinks differently, but I don't presume to say that I can determine what it is. At the end of the day, great literature is writing that moves you greatly. And if you feel at some really powerful level that it has transported you and moved you, affected you, aesthetically, it's breathtaking to you, that's your great literature. So I would tend to say that in your question, both the idea of how do you write about Pakistan and also the idea of what is great literature, to me, it speaks as though there's some external person granting this thing, probably a white person sitting in America or Britain, who says, this is, you know, great. And therefore, the Pakistani writer is upheld by this person who determines great literature. I can see why people would feel that way, and I don't entirely disagree that that's a perception that one can have. But to me, it misses the point entirely. You know, I don't think that any writer I know is writing for some mystical sort of, you know, white powerful audience that is determining their greatness and that is, you know, anointing them. And if they write badly about Pakistan, the white man claps. I think, you know, the first step to becoming an adult is taking responsibility for yourself. And I take responsibility for my writing. It is the way I want it to be. I don't need a conspiracy of white people telling me what to do to write this way. If my novels are terrible, they're terrible because I write terribly. And I think in Pakistan generally, we maybe too often talk about, you know, how we're pandering to other people or being manipulated by other people, etc., etc., and not often enough about people are just doing what they want to do. It's their fault, their responsibility. They should take the thing. So, I mean, that would be my reaction to the question. And I really do feel you decide what great literature is. I don't decide that, and nobody else does.
Next, do we have another query? Front row.
I'd like to ask you about the narrative technique. Like, for instance, it was in the last one, the reluctant fundamentalist, it was a dramatic monologue. And I would say, out of that, my last touches, this is a prose narrative and as a dramatic monologue. So I would like to ask about the narrative technique of this one. Is it also a kind of a dramatic monologue or whose addressee is unknown? Over there, yes, we could say and see an addressee in the last one. But what would you say?
I don't think it's anything with as nice a name as that. I mean, dramatic monologue is a very particular, peculiar form. It's as though the two of us are sitting here and H.M. is speaking to me and I'm never speaking and he's going to talk as though there's two people here. I might not even be on the stage. And that in a play becomes a dramatic monologue, and that form in a novel is the dramatic monologue, and that is how The Rotten Fundamentalist is built. But this novel is a second person novel. You are the character of the novel. And the reader in this novel is and I think in all novels, but in this novel explicitly, is a character, a creator, a maker of the story, and also a reader. And so in a way, the novel is, it's a second person narrative, and if I had to think of, you know, a literary, trope, antecedent, have you ever read those Choose Your Own Adventure books? There are these books, when we were small, at least in Lahore, this is 1980s I'm talking about, there were these books called Choose Your Own Adventure books. So you'd open the book and you'd be on planet Altair and you'd be in the spaceship, and at the end of the page it would say, well, if you launch your rocket booster, go to page 66. But if you eject from the capsule, go to page 42. And then you'd go to page 42 or 66, depending on what you chose. And then it would say...
What would you do in that situation?
Rocket booster, for sure.
Okay. I
think, you know, escape capsule first page feels like a real cop-out. More of a short story writer choice. but, you know, and so that is an antecedent. The other big antecedent for me is Dungeons and Dragons, which is this game that we used to play as kids, which is that you basically pretend to be, you know, elves or orcs or whatever, and you have these characters. It's like what the kids are playing now on computers. You know, they're playing these massive multiplayer online games where they're going and chopping the heads off of monsters, etc. Well, we played in the pre-computer era, or pre-common, the available computer game era. Atari was around, but there wasn't this kind of high-tech stuff. We played Dungeons and Dragons, and in that, you are the character. And so, I have always viewed the novel as closer to a video game than a movie. I think there's a lot of agency that readers bring to the novel. You know, sometimes you will see a movie of a novel, or you will read a novel a second time, and you'll realize that you were passionately convinced that this character was, you know, X. And when you read back, you were wrong. And in fact, you know, this person was you know, a man, and you thought it was a woman, or was old, you thought they were young, or, you know, had their head chopped off, and you thought that they were, you know, a regular, realistic figure. And when you realize that, you recognize that you invented that book the first time you read it. It doesn't exist anywhere else. It's just H.M.'s reading, or just Mohsin's reading, or just your reading. So my antecedents, I think, are from that side. I really view the reader as a creator and as an active agent in a book. And so I write books that open up space and in fact can only work if readers create stuff.
Do we have time for another question or are we done? Do we have time for another question? One more question. Final question of the, the session.
We asked you about responsibility. My question is from a different angle. I wanted to ask if you ever wondered what your work, how your work contributes to society in general, or is it in the end just about self-satisfaction or perhaps making you happy because you're doing something you love? Do you ever wonder how it affects society?
I do, but you see, the thing is, as a novelist, you know, I think, generally speaking, you know, novelists are egomaniacs. Every novelist thinks that they're the greatest
Speak
thing.
For yourself,
yes,
yourself.
H.M. is the only exception, you know. But you know, basically, novelists think, you know, very highly of themselves. That oh, I'm making art. You know, I'm doing this, etc., etc., etc. And so, I think it's important, as much as I can, to try to keep that kind of nonsense under control. You know, I have a problem and I don't want to get carried away. So I don't like saying, oh, you know, my novels will impact society and change this country. I believe it, that be very honest. I think, you know, my novels are going to transform the world. But it's such a ridiculous thing for me to believe, and it's so dangerous to start thinking along those lines, that I think, you know, sometimes my ego just exploded out of my chest. Sometimes it's important to shut up about what good you think you're doing, if you want to do any good. Because by shutting up, you can focus on the internal battle of doing something that you think is worthwhile. So in that sense, you know, of course I believe the novel has a social function. And of course, I believe it should change society for the better. And of course, you know, all of those things, I believe all of that. But it's dangerous territory. You know, if your friend needs a loan, you give them a loan, you don't talk about it, right? So I think same thing with fiction writing. The best stuff in the fiction writing, and the reason why talking too much about it publicly is dangerous, because the best stuff is the sincere stuff. And the really sincere stuff in life, you know, you can't express it. And you shouldn't. And if you try to, religion is a great example of this, I feel personally, that the spirituality side of religion, when addressed directly, not through metaphorical poetry or whatever else, but when you talk directly, I believe this, it must be like this, etc., 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 I think it can be dangerous. It can be dangerous for the spirit. You know, one of the best things I ever heard about religion, my khala told me, and I'd come back from college in America, and I was saying, okay, you believe this, and why do you believe this? She said, I'm not going to tell you. I said, you know, how can you not tell me? We're having a conversation. You can't say, I'm not going to tell you. And she said, look, it's personal. It's between me and my God. I don't want to talk to you about it. And I thought, you know, it stopped me in my tracks, and I thought, you know, that's probably the smartest advice I've ever had, you know, on this topic from anyone. That, you know, for her, it's sincere, and there's no reason to debate it with a punk nephew who wants to, you know, take on her views on whatever. And so, you know, your question about the social impact of a novel and trying to do all these things, yes, I think it does. I think it can, and I believe in it. And I'm a passionately engaged citizen, and I care about this country, and I want this country to do well, and I live here, and I've chosen to live here. You know, I've just had my children here and be here. So I'm a believer in Pakistan, like hardcore. But all of that said, it's best not to talk too much about it, I think. Just do it and keep your mouth shut.
Just do it and keep your mouth shut. I think we're done.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Very amazing presentation. And especially by the way,
Thank you, sir.